think about future options for farming in general. And I'm going to do that from a global perspective, mostly. With examples from the Netherlands, but also from other parts of the world. So when we think about the future of farming, actually we should perhaps start thinking about the past and how did we actually get to this situation, this kind of landscape. This is an agricultural landscape in Argentina, where I come. And what I mean, you know, going to the past, I mean really going to the past and thinking about the history of the earth, 4.5 billion years, right? And humans, we are here only in the last 2 million years, so we're almost invisible there at the top of this figure here. Photosynthesis, for instance, started 3.5 billion years, right? And plants, 200 years ago, or 1 million years ago, things like those. The Amazon forest, for instance, is 60 million years old. So when we came on Earth, the Amazon forest was already 60 million years old, or 58, actually. Now, since we're here, we're actually being, marauding around, walking around, and changing the ecosystems, which we were actually serving ourselves from animals and from fruits and from those kind of things. And only in the last 6,000 or 7,000 years, actually, when the climate became quite stable, we decided to sit calm and to become sedentary, to start building cities, to start doing agriculture. So agriculture is actually responsible for the first population boom, human population boom. And the expansion of our population actually went in detriment of other species of the megafauna. So we are part of the megafauna, and there's no offense intended here. Anything between a sheep and an elephant qualifies as megafauna. Agriculture started simultaneously in many parts of the world. Almost, in parts we are not connected with each other. So it was quite a successful strategy from an ecological perspective, from a species perspective. And our expansion in numbers went in detriment of the numbers of other species, as I said before. When put it in terms of biomass and not in numbers, but if we take the weight of all the megafauna species and humans, actually there is kind of a replacement, right? And this replacement is a little bit in equilibrium with the amount of energy that reaches the air, the earth every year. But when we look at the situation today, if we assume that this is the Earth carrying capacity, the amount of megafauna biomass that the Earth can sustain based on solar energy, actually we are far beyond the carrying capacity of the Earth. And what we're doing, how are we doing that? Well, basically using fossil fuels, using energy that was actually accumulated over 60 million years. We're running out of it. And the reason, the best perhaps illustration of that is the expansion of the areas of exploration for oil, for fossil energy. We're running out of it, so we're destroying boreal forests to get the last drop of oil from the Arctic soils. Now, let's go a little bit closer in history. You know who this person is? Yusuf von Liebig? No? He was one of the fathers of agriculture. Is the person who actually discovered that when you apply manure to a crop, it's actually not necessarily the manure that does the trick, but it's the nutrients contained in the manure. So he said, well, we can actually isolate those nutrients, have a solution, and apply those nutrients and the plants will grow. So that's the creation of fertilizers. Right? But he was actually also the inventor of this, he made his money with this, actually. And he wrote this very influential treaty where he said all the things, and he talked about how plants respond to fertilizer, basically to nutrients, using these kind of models. You know, the more nutrients you apply, the more the crop will grow, the more yield you're going to get, until a certain point, etc., etc. But in reality, we don't always see these kind of response curves. We very often see things like this. You know, situations in which already without nutrient input, the yields are quite high, and situations in which, even though we put a lot of inputs, the yields don't go up. And that last situation is very common in Africa, for instance, where soils are either inherently very poor, like these sandy soils formed of Kalahari sands, or soils are very degraded. So when we try to restore the fertility of these soils using fertilizers or using manure, what we see is that in spite of asking the poor farmer to invest the money he doesn't get half, to buy fertilizers, his yields, look at the white bars here, his especially not in a dry year, relatively dry year. But the yields slowly go up with manure application, obviously. Right? So this is not rocket science. And actually, I don't know why we did this experiment, because actually, in the 19th century, 20 years after von Liebig published his first treaty, then he came up with this other book. And here, he was 20 years older. And people say, when you become older, you become greener. So he said something like this. Adding chemical mixtures to soil without organic matter has in the long term he said brandy. As an uneducated people, he said laziness. It was not very politically correct. Or perhaps in that context he was. So we know this already from 150 years. Why are we still trying with fertilizers without organic matter? And this situation I was describing before of soils that do not respond to fertilizers is actually, it represents about 25% of all the arable land, which is in a severely degraded state. One reason for that is having moved from big biomass varieties of cereals to small biomass and compact cereal plants, which can actually withstand a lot of nitrogen application without So these varieties, these old varieties, all these biomass here and in the root systems, that was the input of carbon to the soil every year. Right? When you move to the smaller varieties, the input of carbon goes down. That also costed us 50 petagrams of carbon from the Earth's surface, this change. Right? That's a lot of carbon. That's half of the carbon stocks in the top soils that we lost. Now, closer in history, the Green Revolution and all the promises that technologies could bring about, right? DDT is good for me, DDT is good for you, DDT can be used, to impregnate wallpapers to, for your children so the mosquitoes will not bother them. Let you see how he looks like today. But the funny thing about this is that they were using very tender images to sell poison, right? Like very tender, sorry, it's an Argentinian, very tender images of mama with a baby, And science was actually saying there is nothing wrong with DDT. Right? There is no scientific proof that DDTs are bad for anyone, for environment or for humans or for anything. So you could use DDT to fumigate children in the swimming pools or to treat the eyes or whatever. Science was saying there's no problem. 30 years later, this paper came out. And this person, William Dyckman, was actually the leading scientist who did the experiments to actually release DDT. So he was the one who said, well, there's no problem with DDT. 30 years later, he came out with this paper where he says, we're sorry, actually there are problems with DDT. So what happened in those 30 years? What changed? Well, on the one hand, cumulative effect. After 30 years, you start seeing problems that you don't see in 2 or 3 years. Right? And on the second hand, and most importantly, science progresses, and the methods we have to detect the problems also become more and more accurate. Right? So many of the things that we are releasing to the environment today, we think are safe. Perhaps we don't have the right methods to understand how harmful they could be. So we need to learn from these histories. And nowadays, they don't use babies, but they use all types of tender images to sell poison. And the new baby that we see today is the sustainability. Right? That's a new baby that we use to sell things, the sustainable intensification discourse. Sorry to go into this, but when I read the introduction to the workshop, I saw what is sustainable intensification. I just wanted to give some examples of what sustainable intensification, how it is being presented. Now, agroecology, what is agroecology? What's the alternative to that, to all that I was describing before? Well, agroecology is the application, I think most of us know this definition, application of principles of nature, principles of ecology to design and management of agricultural systems. Right? Or nowadays, we talk about sustainable food systems, not only agricultural systems. Now, in simpler words, actually agroecology is nothing else than farming with nature, learning from nature, actually using the principles of nature. And there is no recipe here. There are no technological packages because every site is different, every context is different, every farm is different. But what we have is principles: diversity, recycling, efficiencies, etc., etc. Those are the principles. Then you define your technology, you define your method, you find your practice. In parallel, there is another movement which is comparable in terms of principles, which is the idea of cradle to cradle, which comes from industrial design, as you know. In both movements, there is something in common, the idea that, waste is food. Because actually, there is no waste in nature, right? Waste is a human invention. So in nature, anything that is waste is actually used by another organism. And this is an underlying and common factor in these two type of movements, agroecology and the cradle-to-cradle movement. Let me show you an example of this. This comes from the coastal areas of Peru. These are places where it never rains. And with the little irrigation water this they can get, farmers are able to create these oases, combining trees and crops and livestock, but always cows. And with the refusal of those livestock, they produce compost and they produce biogas and they recycle the rest and use it to fertilize the soil, and they get very good soil fertility, very good soil biology, biological activity in these, you know, desert soils. So this is an example of an agroecological system. And agroecology was first used in science as a scientific discipline. The term was first used in the 30s. Then it was developed into a practice only later on in the 70s. And it became a scientific discipline following farmer innovations in the 80s. Right? It's quite recent as a scientific discipline. And one important element of agroecology is the social organization. All this knowledge that farmers have about recycling, etc., they are not spread by international organizations or by national systems or anything like that. It's actually a farmer-to-farmer system of knowledge sharing, right? So this is what we say that actually it's almost impossible to imagine agroecology without social organizations, social movements that support that type of agriculture. The Latin American Society for Agroecology is one of the first organizations formally created to support and to promote agroecology, and has a voice over a number of issues, international issues like climate change, etc. And in recent years, national research organizations like the INRA in France or the INTA in Argentina actually are trying to embrace agroecology. The Minister of Agriculture in France, he said, agroecology is the future for France. I don't know what he means by agroecology, but he said that. And so INRA and INTA and all these organizations that deal with large-scale farming are now thinking, how do we translate the principles of agroecology into applicable practices for these large-scale commercial farmers? A real challenge. And the country that has the best example of agroecology at a large scale and widely adopted is Brazil. Brazil even has the first national policy on agroecology, which is part of the program Fome Zero, Hunger, Zero Hunger, right? Which is a program that actually is responsible for having stopped hunger in Brazil in the space of 10 years, right? Using agroecological principles. Now, I'm sure you've heard about these debates, right? Very often. There are different views on what agroecology is, and especially in Latin America, there is a certain view of what organic farming is, and very often there is this controversy in saying, well, is actually organic farming agroecology, or are all organic farmers agroecological farmers? Are all agroecological farmers necessarily organic, etc., etc.? And this is something I'd like to perhaps put there as a question to the debate later on, but I'd like to show some examples to illustrate why I think what I think about this question. So the first one is this, and for that I'm going to make a risky move. Not so risky. Show a video of a farmer in the Netherlands.
Sinds 2000 heb ik het bedrijf al gevolgd van de ouders. En toen heb uitsteken, dus met de precisie zuidmachine. Daar creëren we dus een gunstiger klimaat voor de opkomst van het zaad. En daarnaast, doordat we ruimere zaadafstand hebben, hebben we dus minder last van ziekte. En ja, spuiten doen we sowieso niet, maar het hoeft eigenlijk ook niet in ons systeem. Dus je gaat ooit van een wijnplant, maar die zich wel optimaal kunnen ontwikkelen, tot en met een oogst. De biologische landbouw, die doet het nog lang niet goed zoals we het zouden willen, wat brandstofverbruik betreft. Maar het teeltsysteem zoals we het nu geruime tijd hanteren en niet meer ploegen, zorgt dat voor veel minder emissies. We hebben minder bodembewerkingen nodig, minder zware machines die over het land hoeven, omdat die bodem die, zich veel beter manifesteert. We weten nu inmiddels wat chemicaliën en wat kunstmeststoffen doen met het bodemleven. En omdat we die niet meer gebruiken, is heel die bodem die we hier hebben, is totaal veranderd. Die opbouw van de bodemleven is veranderd, de opbouw, de organische stofgehalte. En dat is eigenlijk een dusdanige verandering, die kun je, in de geïndustrialiseerde landbouw, krijg je daar niet voor elkaar. Het is puur ontwikkeling. Elk jaar leggen we de lat een stukje hoger. We weten, we kunnen op dit moment al met weinig input ook een goede oogst halen die op hetzelfde niveau ligt dan de traditionele of geïndustrialiseerde landbouw. Dus wat maakt ons, waarom zouden we ons zorgen maken dat het niet verder zich kan ontwikkelen? Ik denk dat we binnen 10, 15 jaar toch zeker naar die 15 ton kunnen toegroeien. En dat is eigenlijk 50% meer dan we nu hebben. Ja, ik voel me ontzettend gelukkig. Ja.
So why did I choose this example? Well, because I think he actually, this farmer case, actually brings together a lot of things that we need for agroecological innovations. That is knowledge, technology, respecting and learning from nature, farmer innovation itself, etc., etc. Now, it's of course not your average farmer. It's an innovating farmer. And it's a person who, for instance, he didn't want to have his sewing machine behind her, so he developed these strange tractors to have the sewing train in front of him, so he could see how the sewing was happening. So it's a real innovator, uses the latest technologies, and also is an innovator in the way he sells his product. I'm only showing wheat here, but he has 18 different crops on his farm. Right? And he's always experimenting with new cover crops, new cotton curry systems, new green manures, etc., etc. So that's the type of farmer we need to actually make agricultural progress in these kind of systems. Now, another example. We don't see as much diversity in those fields as we may see in a farming in Indonesia or in Brazil, in a tropical area where we see all that diversity of agroforestry, etc. But there is a lot of diversity that we don't see, and it's very important, as you know, which is soil life. In this particular experiment in the Netherlands, on a dairy grassland, dairy production grassland, we were actually trying to look at the effect of different types of manure, different qualities of manure, on soil life. How this, the application of manure, affected different life forms in the soil. But what we discovered there is that the manure that was coming from the same farm was decomposing faster than the manure that was coming from another farm. Right? Every time I tell this to farmers, they say, well, of course, everyone knows that. We scientists, we didn't know necessarily that. Right? And we start developing all these ideas, all these theories of coevolution of rumen bacteria and soil bacteria and all that, right? Which is very interesting because actually it calls for the need to design mixed systems, shows the efficiency of having mixed systems, right? 10 years ago, or a little bit more earlier than that, people from Feeble came out with this very interesting paper in which they said they showed for the first time with real data, with long-term trials, that organically managed soils were more diverse, are more diversity of species, life forms, but also the diversity of enzymes and functions in the soil. Now, skepticals looked at this and said, well, why do you need so much diversity in the soil? What's the relationship between diversity and yields? Why do you need, how much diversity do you need in the soil? So nowadays, actually, with the development of the DNA mapping techniques among structures in the soil. Right? So all of this comes to actually bring scientific evidence of why we should go in a certain direction in terms of management. And agroecology or organic farming can also represent a viable and economically viable alternative for large-scale farming. I'm not going to say that this is the common picture in Argentina, but you see more and more farms of large scale actually going in this direction in different ways, not necessarily certified, etc., but moving in that direction using agroecological principles, using the latest knowledge and technology available, like nanotechnologies to detect plant diseases before the symptoms show up, for instance, etc., etc. Now, imagine I was the other day discussing this idea. I said, well, you know this system, right, to book a taxi. So basically you match a person who needs to go somewhere and doesn't have a car with a person who has a car and doesn't know where to go or nothing else to do. So you put them together and you get an informal taxi system that brings people around, right? And that's possible because of clouds of data that you can access with smartphones. Now, you could do the same with consumers and producers. So I thought, what a great idea, and I'd like to have somebody in the audience who has the capacity to bring this to reality. Until I met a Kenyan woman who's actually doing this. It's a system which is called M-Farm. I recommend you to look it up on the internet, M-Farm. And she already has 10,000 farmers that she's connecting them to consumers. She's aggregating their production using not necessarily a smartphone, but mobile phone technology. So very interesting development. Now, agroecology is knowledge intensive, and let me show you another example of why I'm saying this and how we need to actually foster this dialogue of wisdom between farmer knowledge and scientific knowledge. Learn from nature, learn from and with farmers, make use of biodiversity, and use the latest knowledge and technologies available from science. Let's take the example of biological control, or actually ecosystem services like biological control and pollination, which are mediated by arthropods, insects, and others. So for instance, we know these calculations. Huh? For example, we calculate that it's about $400 billion, that's the value of biological control every year. That's really huge. But we're making their life, the life of these insects, of these natural enemies, very difficult because we are destroying their habitats. Now, how do we create habitats for them to have them in the landscape? Well, we need to actually look at the landscape, for instance, this landscape here. We look at it from the perspective of these friends here. So for instance, if you need nectar, actually this landscape, it looks like a desert, right? If you need to eat aphids, actually this looks like a very interesting landscape for you. So the moment we start looking at the landscape in this, from this perspective, we can actually start designing landscapes which are pest suppressive. For instance, in this case, we have an example in which the level of parasitism of a certain caterpillar with a certain wasp actually decreases very abruptly as we move away from the forest or from the woodland. Right? That means that for a control of this particular pest, this is not a very good landscape design. We will need natural habitats or semi-natural habitats dispersed along the landscape. So this information is very important. Now imagine that we want to take this to a real case. And this is a case from the Netherlands. This is a polder. And obviously, we don't talk about natural vegetation in a polder, we talk about semi-natural vegetation. And every point there is actually a potential habitat. Right? For every dot there, we have information about the species that are there, and also about their biology, I mean, their dynamics in time. Right? Because if you want to have a certain wasp to act as a natural enemy to a certain pest, this wasp needs nectar, and it will only get it from a certain type of flower that matches the shape of its mouthparts. Right? So you need the right type of flower at the right time, in the right distribution in the landscape, to be able to have biological control by this particular insect. So it actually is very knowledge intensive, as I said. This is ecological engineering. Right? But this is not the most complex issue. The most complex issue of designing this type of landscapes is actually the social issue. Right? Because a landscape is not a single farm. Many farms working together. So if we want to have a landscape design, we need to have all the actors who are at stake in that landscape and actually get them to negotiate what is the best landscape for everyone. Because from a biological control perspective, we want to have more hedgerows, but people also live there and they want to see the church of the town from the window, so you don't want to have hedgerows or things like that. So you need to have these negotiations, and we scientists also need to deliver tools that can support these negotiations. And one of those tools are models, but not necessarily mathematical models always. Also models, like you can model the landscape and discuss and have negotiations about how the landscape should look like. Right? And of course also mathematical models that can give some numbers to put on the table and discuss the model. So if we know all this, if we have all those tools, if we have all this knowledge, what is preventing change? What is change not coming along? Well, people say perhaps we're putting the cart in front of the horse. Perhaps that's the problem. A couple of years ago, there were two papers that were done, that were published at the same time. The studies were done in parallel without communicating with each other. One was published in Agricultural Systems, the other one was published in Nature. And in both cases, they arrived at the same conclusion. They compared the yields of organic farming versus conventional farming. I'm sure you came across this. And they found that the average difference in yield was 20% between organic and conventional farming worldwide under experimental conditions. I asked for the data myself, and I did some trials to see, well, is there any distribution issue or something? And no, it's 20%. Now, 20% is the difference in yield. How about the differences in investment? Because when we look at the investment in research, most of the money for research goes into methods for conventional agriculture, either from the public sector or from the private sector. The Netherlands is a pioneering country in terms of investing money in research for organic farming. And in 2012, when I did this study, they invested about 4 million. And the same year, a company like Monsanto invested 980 million in research, right, which is 10% of their sales. So you see, the research gap is much wider than the actual yield gap. So that is one of the things that prevents change. Now, the problem of analyzing yields of conventional organic farming on a one-year basis is that we are not really looking at the right indicators to compare systems. Because in the long term, we need to consider rotations and we need to consider community effects. For that, we have some long-term trials in the world, especially in the United States, which are comparing organic versus conventional for over 20 years or more. For instance, this experiment, the Russell Ranch, is an experiment of 100 years that started in 1960. They're planning to go for 100 years. They compare different systems and they get something like this. And this is why it's important to measure not only one system. Look at this. This is the yield of tomatoes in this case. Three different ways of growing tomatoes. If you would run your experiments in the year 94, your conclusion would be that green is better than blue and blue is better than red. If you would run your experiment only in the year 95, your conclusion would be that red is better than green and green is better than blue. If you would have run your experiment only in the 96, then there's no difference. So that means that the difference between systems is really year dependent, season dependent. So when we look now at the long term, we see that the red one is actually more stable. It's perhaps not always the highest yielding, but it's the more stable over time. Right? It's not surprisingly that's the organic one. And another reason to look at it in the long term is that many of the benefits of soil diversification and functions in the soil actually start showing up after a number of years of doing a certain type of management in the soil. Rodale, also a long-term experiment, also shows the same thing. Every time there is a dry year, organic does better than conventional. Well, it's not rocket science, actually, very, very logical. And that means that from the point of view of climate change adaptation, organic farmers have a higher performance. And in terms of economics, it's the same in dry years. And in terms of input use, in terms of energy inputs, in terms of greenhouse gas emissions, of course, conventional farm, conventional yields are higher environmental costs. So all these analyses of long-term trials are actually reported in this report from the FAO, which was not very known, very well known, which is very interesting. It brings together a lot of long-term experiments from around the world. And we did a review last year, actually published this year, in which we look at the most recent literature on the effect of organic farming and agroecology on climate change adaptation and mitigation. we reviewed 97 published references, 97 papers, scientific papers. And from the review of those 97 papers, we got to the conclusion that organic and agroecological farming systems perform better in a number of things: carbon sequestration, energy use efficiency, etc., etc. So the evidence, the scientific evidence, is mounting that organic systems are better prepared for a changing climate. Now, this is mostly for the scientists in the room. We also need to actually question ourselves and think, how are we doing science? I mean, most of the science we've done in agriculture has been developed to actually respond to the needs of these kind of systems, and less so to the needs of these kind of systems, more complex systems. For us scientists, moving from the first system to the second system, moving from classical agronomy to they say from population agronomy to community agronomy, means moving from autoecology to scene ecology, right? Means moving from seeing diversity as a burden, weeds and uniformity, etc., to diversity as an attribute, right? And this, I'm not going to go into detail with this, it's in a publication, but this also has implications for the type of indicators we need to use to compare systems. We cannot compare organic and conventional using yields, because yields is something that comes from the conventional school, right? We need a different indicator for organic. Now, transitioning towards the systems we want, let's call them agroecological systems or sustainable systems, sustainable food systems or landscapes, etc., etc. We know that they require technical innovation, but they also require institutional innovation, right? Institution, we need knowledge, we need credit, we need markets, we need lots of things. Now, how do we move up? Well, for sure, the trajectory between the current systems and the desirable systems is not going to be a direct line, but for simplicity, I'm going to make it like this, a straight line. But what we see is what we call a bottleneck, right? And this bottleneck is the input substitution system, or the input substitution way of practicing intensive grazing. So if we follow the idea of sustainable intensification, that discourse, it's actually a discourse that leads for an optimization of the existing system. So you take the system of today, and you use precision agriculture or a different type of pesticides, but you don't really change the system. You just use the system as it is, monocultures, etc. Use only, be more efficient. That's the discourse. Now, when there are regulations, when there is consumer demands, then we move towards the input substitution. Okay, we don't challenge the system, but instead of using chemical fertilizer, we use organic fertilizer. We're still keeping a monoculture and thinking the same way we thought before. Now, this is a transition moment, right, towards a system redesign. For instance, okay, now we're gonna go into a completely different thing. We're gonna move from arable farming to agroforestry or to mixed farming so that's a completely different configuration of the system. And that's what we need actually to progress towards sustainable development. And this needs to go together with the social organization that was mentioned before and with the territorial development measures. But I would like to go back to this point, because many organic farmers that we know are trapped into this situation. Right? Organic farmers in the Netherlands are farming on land that costs 80,000 euros a hectare. Right? So they have a big debt with the bank, and the bank is telling them what to do, and they are not in a big space for maneuvering. They're actually constrained to do a certain number of things. Right? So that's why we need support for farmers who are in transition. Most farmers who are here are actually trying to move in that direction, but they are trapped by a system that keeps them there. So that's why next to technical innovation and institutional innovation, we also need political innovation, right? In which we have carrots, which are bigger than the sticks. Preferably sticks which are more human friendly than this one. And this is needed urgently, because farmers, especially in Europe, are getting old. No offense, but the average age of a farmer is reaching 60 years old, right? Their children are not taking over. So we need to make farming more attractive to the younger generation, like the ones we have here today. So this is very important. And another important, another area we need very, very serious discussion is the food chain. Because this is an example from the Netherlands where we see a diagram that shows 65,000 farmers feeding 17 million people in the Netherlands, and everything is controlled by five big wholesalers and retailers. Right? And you don't see it from there, but there are a few lines of innovations that go like community-supported agriculture and the like. Right? But still, the whole system is dominated by a few big companies, and this is also not a big room for innovation. It doesn't need a big room for innovation. Let me finish with this. What I think about the relation between organic agriculture and agroecology. I think that agroecology can provide knowledge to guide sustainable farming in general, and obviously also organic farming. Most organic farmers already follow agroecological principles, so I don't see much of a difference between approaches, although we know that when we look at this, you know, 1,000 hectares of organic lettuce in California, well, that's not really very agroecological. Although it's certified organic, perhaps we should take the principles of agroecology and incorporate them in the certification systems that we're using, so we don't certify some monoculture. And then, agroecology, as I've insisted a couple of times, requires this dialogue of wisdoms, farmer knowledge and scientific knowledge. We need to find a different way of doing science. Thank you very much.